Land of Mordor, where the shadows lie.
These words are among the most distinctive phrases in literature of modern times. While the poem is grim in tone and theme, the work from which it comes is loved by millions around the world, in every major language and culture. The Lord of the Rings.
There is no such thing as a natural death. Nothing that happens to man is ever natural, since his presence calls the whole world into question. All men must die, but for every man, his death is an accident. And even if he knows it and consents to it, an unjustifiable violation. Well, you may agree with words or not, but those are the key spring of the laws of the ring.
One of the marks of a great work of literature is that it reflects time-honored literary motifs and has unique qualities. Lord of the Rings displays this blend of tradition and originality.
Austrog Vestri, Alfjover, Dvalin, Beaver, Bauver, Bumber, Nori, Alnog Alnar, Awe Mjöðvitnir, Vegur Gandalfur. The Völuspá is an Old Norse poem, very well known to Tolkien, which gives a complete history of the world from its creation to its ultimate destruction and some hopes of a recreation of the world subsequently, and all of the causes along the way. Tolkien took his dwarf names for the Hobbit and the name of Gandalf chiefly from this list.
Tolkien's creation of the Rings of Power was also inspired by the ancient tales, the Nibelungenlied and Volsungasaga, particularly the tale of Sigurd and the dragon Fafnir.
Accumulation of rings in Fafnir's or Fafnir's treasure, where the dying dragon says to Sigurd, "Those rings will be the death of you." So it's very much that one ring will be the death of you, and will be the cause of great harm. You shouldn't take it away.
Professor Verlin Flieger has explored ancient mythology and its relationship to Tolkien's work.
He felt very strongly that England didn't have a mythology, that the Celts had one, the classical mythology of the Greeks and Romans was there, and I think it was Kalevala that inspired him to write collection of tales, as he described it, some described in full and some only sketch, that would become for his country, not for everybody's England, but maybe for his England, the mythology that it needed.
Professor Tom Shippey has spent much of his academic career examining Tolkien's interest in languages and then analyzing its impact on the author's creative work.
Tolkien, I think you could say, was interested in the mechanics of language at a time when most people, you know, nearly everybody, just never realized it at all. I think there is a kind of linguistic gift, same as there is a mathematical gift, and same as there is a gift for playing chess, and that you do get, as it were, virtuosos in language as you do in music. And virtuosos in music can do things that the rest of us, you know, can't even imagine. Same way, I think, with people who are really good at language. Tolkien is obviously one of those.
Tolkien was about the sound of language. He was about language as music, okay? Language for him was primarily about sound. He said, cellar door. Well, he would have said it in dialect, cellar door. Cellar door was the most beautiful sequence of sounds in the English language. He says, particularly when you divorce it from the meaning. And in that sense, the Elvish poetry is exactly the same thing as the English poetry. So when he writes, Lauria lantar lassi surinin, the virtue of that is exactly the same virtue that you get in The leaves were long, the grass is green, the hemlock umbels tall and fair.
In an interview at the conference of the Mythopoeic Society, Philippa Boyens, writer of New Line Cinema's films of Lord of the Rings, charms the audience with a rendition of Tolkien's Elvish.
So the world has changed. I can feel it in the water. I can feel it in the air. I can smell it in the air.
Tolkien also thought that there was, as it were, a prehistory to even to old English literature, that what we got was not the start of a tradition, it was the end of a tradition. The history of the people, these could all be fitted together. And what you did was it created a picture of what might have been. Well, Tolkien, I think, had this idea, so to speak, of asterisk reality. And he meant, I've reconstructed this, we have no records about this, or at least we only have traces of it. But if you follow back the traces, you can see that there was something behind all those traces, and we really believe in that. For instance, Beowulf is quite clearly a, what the Germans call a Märchenepos, a fairy tale epic. Actually, fairy tales and epics aren't like each other. Fairy tales are kind of little things, you know, two or three pages long, often thought to be for children, and epics are great big enormous things, very much thought to be the highest work of the adult mind. So fairy tale epic, that sounds like another contradiction in terms. Of course, they continued to say it couldn't be done. And you might say Tolkien said, okay, they say it can't be done, I'll show them.
Through the speculation of a time, a history, or a prehistory world, Tolkien invented the term subcreation in a seminal essay called On Fairy Stories.
The achievement of the expression, which gives, or seems to give, the inner consistency of reality, is indeed another thing, or aspect, needing another name. Art, the operative link between imagination and the final result, subcreation.
But he believed that God was a creator, and we are made in the image of God. And one of the key ways in which we're made in the image of God is our desire to create. But we can't create because we can only use what is created. We can only use what's already there. So what we do is use that, we subcreate.
Because that seems to be the core of what fantasy literature is about. He certainly goes to great lengths to portray these fantastic elements as being perfectly normal within that world. I mean, I think that's something that all good fantasy writers do, just to create the impression this is the way things are in that world, and you just sort of accept it, you know, while you're reading the story.
So it's very much not fantasy as in an escapist sense, as is often implied by critics that don't understand his work. It's hyper-real. It's real in a transcendent sense, because it's actually a universe which parallels, in an orthodox fashion, the real universe.
Fantasy author Peter Beagle discusses a key feature of epic literature, the quest.
The quest is always the one of the major motifs in fairy tales, certainly, and in legends. And the quest itself is usually more important than what's found at the end of it. It's what happens during the quest to the searchers that's the real story.
What you're a hero for, as the Old Norse see it, is til fjordr prægðr, for wealth and fame. So here's Tolkien trying to create a hero who isn't in it for wealth or fame, and isn't in it for revenge either.
Unlike traditional stories, the quest in Lord of the Rings is not to obtain a powerful object, but to destroy one.
Now, at this last, we must take a hard road, a road unforeseen. There lies our hope, if hope it be, to walk into peril to Mordor. We must send the ring to the fire.
It's almost an end quest. It's a quest to undo a great evil. Could we do that now? Do we do that? Do we look at things that we know to be powerful, enormously powerful? Do we have the strength and courage to undo them?
Matt Armstrong, the yummiest crush of my life. Thought more about spitballs than me. My obvious beauty potential eluded him.
Sometimes where beauty comes from can be rather unexpected.
Take Head & Shoulders. I used it and unexpectedly wound up with this smooth and silky hair. It's like beauty queen hair.
Inside a dandruff shampoo, Head & Shoulders gives you 8 surprising ways to see nothing but beautiful hair.
Eat your heart out, Maddie.
Clean up the 90s again with Big Shiny 90s Volume 2. Featuring Hole, James Addiction, Bush, Jesus Jones, Marilyn Manson, Prodigy, Garbage, U2, White Zombie, Weezer, Oasis, Filter, The Odds, Smash Mouth, Chemical Brothers, and more. Much Music's Big Shiny 90s Volume 2 in stores now.
Girl Tasha, that lashful girl, said, "There's no way I'm gonna comb and then curl." Triple mascara thickens, separates, and curls in one quick step. It's wow in a wink. Now in waterproof. Easy breezy, beautiful CoverGirl.
If it's dust you can't ignore, Uniswiffer. On the shelf, TV, and more, Uniswiffer.
Swiffer Duster traps and locks dust on contact. You've never cleaned like this before.
Swiffer's good.
Stop cleaning. Start Swiffering.
Lord of the Rings, like much of Western literature, from the Odyssey through Paradise Lost to Idylls of the King, dramatizes the eternal conflict between the forces of darkness and light.
The hobbits represent, for Tolkien, a kind of homage to the rural England and the rural English people that he knew as a boy.
We also have in the fact that the hobbits are the ones that are chosen, the exaltation of the humble. It's not the great and mighty that have this great and mighty work to do. It's the hobbits who no one's ever heard of in Middle-earth. And you know, all the epic histories of all the battles and all the things that have shaped Middle-earth, the hobbits are overlooked.
These characters represent various sides of humanity. Yet one individual stands above all others. Frodo.
Frodo is almost an anti-romance hero in the sense that he's not tall, he's not strong, and he's not powerful. And we get this sense Frodo knows that it's his calling, it's his vocation. Frodo doesn't want to go on the quest. He's a reluctant hero. Most of the heroes of romances and fantasies are seeking adventure, but Frodo would rather not seek adventure. He'd rather not have the burden of carrying the ring. But he takes it on as his responsibility, knowing that there's something about him that makes it necessary for him to do this.
While Tolkien's good characters aren't perfect, they struggle for a righteous cause. To oppose tyranny, desolation, and enslavement. In short, evil.
So we see, the archetypal battle between good and the bad impulses in man. In the Gandalf versus the Balrog episode, it's another example of the excellent subtle depths in Tolkien's work. Gandalf is emblematic of all that is good, right, just, and merciful,
whereas the Balrog represents all consuming and powerful evil. So when Gandalf says, I am a servant of the secret fire you cannot pass, in that context, it sounds like something that you would say just to daunt a foe. But what we learn in Tolkien's mythology, the secret fire is the ability to bring forth sentient life, which only resides in the One, Tolkien's monotheistic figure. So when Gandalf says, I am a servant of the secret fire, he's essentially saying, I'm a servant of God, I'm an angel.
The evil in Lord of the Rings may appear archetypal, but it also parallels the terrible realities of the modern age.
The worst atrocities of the 20th century, you could say, were, if not carried out, were at least instigated, not by kind of the traditional, you know, bloody-handed villain who murders people because he likes it and or he thinks it's fun or something like that, or just for their money. They're actually carried out by people who've got nice shirts on and collars and ties and go to work in an office and their hands are perfectly clean. But just the same, they create a kind of dreadful, bureaucratic, industrialized, organized operation of evil. I think if you look back over the 20th century, that's the question. Where did it go wrong? Around about 1900, it looks as if we're on a nice upward curve of moral progress and increasing prosperity, and somehow all during Tolkien's lifetime, it all fell apart. He gives us a series of pictures of people in differing stages, as it were, of corruption. The wraiths are there, sort of between death and life, between existence and non-existence, with no passions of their own, no interests of their own. They project instead just sort of dreariness, nothingness, despair. That's their only feeling. Well, you could say, is that not an image of how evil is seen in the 20th century, which is worse than anything we ever saw before?
Fantasy is a kind of, or is seen as a kind of sidebar genre in 20th century literature, I think, where Tolkien transcends that and becomes as modern, if not more modern, than anyone else, is in the subject matter that he chooses, which is war, which is the lust for power.
Perhaps the most striking example of this theme occurs when Saruman the Wizard tries to convince Gandalf to abandon their friends and allies and join the enemy, Sauron.
Elastic and impolite.
We can bide our time. We can keep our thoughts in our hearts, deploring maybe evils done by the way, but approving the high and ultimate purpose, knowledge, rule, order. All the things that we have so far striven in vain to accomplish, hindered rather than helped by our weak or idle friends. There need not be, there would not be any real change in our designs, only in our means.
Well, what does real mean? What do you mean, no real change? What you mean, actually, is that there's going to be a very major change, but we're going to pretend it didn't happen. But you can see that people say that kind of thing to themselves, and they believe it. Well, if that happens, and you say these things and you believe it, then you are sliding down the slope towards the doom.
And thus, the ring looms as a symbol of the worst impulses in human nature.
When you realize the basic plot of The Lord of the Rings, you can't help thinking that the ring represents power. It has all the signs of it. It can be taken up with good intentions, but it will corrupt those good intentions. Nobody can be trusted with it. When Frodo has been led into temptation, he can no longer resist evil. I'm talking about the Lord's Prayer because I think that was very much in Tolkien's mind. The petitions in the Lord's Prayer are, lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. Well, temptation is our responsibility, but evil is outside us.
It's by good deeds, it's by self-sacrifice, and of course key to both of those is the concept of free will. You see this sort of this sublime mystical interlinking between the act of the will, the act of free will, and the love of God, sort of free will and providence working hand in hand. And when the will acts in a self-sacrificial, loving way, providence works with it. When the will acts in a way which goes against the dictates of love, the dictates of self-sacrifice, providence works against it.
In many scenes like that, we have this kind of ambiguity which is never resolved. And The Ring expresses, above all, I think, that ambiguity. We never know whether evil is from inside or from outside, and there are good reasons for thinking both.
The dual nature of the Ring's influence is dramatized in perhaps the most significant character in Lord of the Rings, Gollum.
Gollum modeling Frodo's shadow. Frodo represents a very British attitude towards life, you know, which is, certainly you don't be whiny. Certainly whininess is in the British shadow. You don't get caught being whiny. And Gollum is a whiny guy. And Gollum is very intensely self-interested. Gollum will kill to protect himself.
Gollum haunts me in a way that no other character does. Gollum has been just burned out by this ring that he's possessed for so long that's literally turned him from one thing into another. And yet, what he was before still exists in him. Of all the lines in that trilogy, the one that stays with me is Gollum momentarily talking about a time in the past. Refers to himself first in the third person, when Smeagol was young, when I was young, before the precious came.
I think he's one of the most important characters in 20th century literature. He is a divided character. He so clearly mirrors the terrible pull of good and evil and the ambiguity that must be in human nature when, as a human being, you are pulled both ways. And typical of the 20th century.
Besides the devastation of war, Tolkien's work subtly reflects another grave concern of the 20th century, the environment.
Well, one of the striking things, one of the unusual things about The Lord of the Rings compared to other books is the intense reality of the natural environment, the non-human nature. The environment is a very powerful presence in The Lord of the Rings. The mountains and the forests and the different kinds of environments, each with a kind of people living there or associated with it, the dwarves in the case of the mountains, the elves in the case of the forests, and so on, a kind of people who are appropriate to that kind of natural environment. So I almost think of the Middle Earth as itself a character with perhaps different manifestations. Tolkien had a profound love of the natural world. He combined that love with his profound scholarship and his ability to tell a story. And he put those things together, and it turned out to be a very strong combination.
The Lord of the Rings clearly exhibits the hallmarks of a masterpiece.
Record-breaking sales over the last several months, the Brick has been left with millions of dollars of clearance merchandise. This excess inventory must be reduced during the colossal furniture clearance now at the Brick. Save up to 75% on clearance home furnishings.
Canada is the perfect setting for this film because, in essence, the story is about nothing, existentially. But with killer CGI.
More snow!
You don't have nuclear weapons up here.
Lose the flakes, keep the snow!
But you do have a nuclear winter.
Bobby, you were different from the other kids because you wore your skates on your hands and you turned them into deadly weapons. Remember, you're gonna get revenge on the whole town.
Let's shoot it.
Do you know who Bobby R is? Who is he?
It's got the power to make you move.
17 huge hits, one great CD. Much Dance 2004, featuring Beyonce, Ashanti, Christina Aguilera, Justin Timberlake, Sean Desmond, R. Kelly, Lumidy, Sean Paul, 50 Cent, and more. Much Dance 2004, in stores now.
While other stores have sales all the time, at Moore's, we offer low prices all year long. So when we do have a sale, our prices are even lower. Right now, over half our suits and sport coats are on sale, plus hundreds of pants, sweaters, shirts, shoes, and outerwear, all at big savings. Which means the only way to beat a Moore's price is at the Moore's year-end clearance sale. Well made, well priced, well dressed. Moore's.
Get a DVD for free now at The Brick. When you buy any mattress set from just $3.99, you can get this DVD player free. And you can sleep on your new mattress for 15 months with no payments and no interest.
Lord of the Rings is astonishing for the depth and breadth of reader response. No other work of the 20th century inspired reactions ranging from buying figurines to compiling analyses of the linguistic structures of Tolkien's invented languages. There has been an interesting contrast, and sometimes a conflict, between the views of the literary elite and the common fan.
I'm particularly fond of the publisher's report on the first volume alone, The Fellowship of the Ring. Who is going to read all these hundreds of pages of stuff about strange characters with bizarre names? Maybe nobody, but I still think it's a work of genius, and with my heart in my mouth, I recommend publication.
From the first appearance of The Lord of the Rings, there were some peculiar reviews.
One reviewer once said, this is a jolly, jolly book, isn't it? All the right boys come home and they're happy and glad. It isn't true, of course. He can't have read the story.
When the book came out initially, a lot of indifference. It wasn't even that widely reviewed. And there were a lot of reviews that were quite nice about it, but a lot that were very critical, very nasty, and very dismissive.
Edmund Wilson, when he was writing Axel's Castle, he said very clearly that you've got to keep an open mind on things. He said, if we come upon some new and outlandish piece of writing which we are tempted to characterize as nonsense, balderdash, or gibberish, then we've got to sort of realize that people like it and we must take it seriously. And then, of course, when The Lord of the Rings comes out, the word he uses actually is balderdash. I mean, it's not a common word. Why did he say you mustn't use it and then use it? I think that Edmund Wilson was thinking about James Joyce's Ulysses. He'd been very much one of its supporters. It had been characterized as nonsense, balderdash, gibberish, and he wanted to say, no, you know, you must be open-minded. You must be open-minded about things that I like, but things I don't like, you can remain closed-minded about.
The only really great one, really, was C.S. Lewis. I mean, he wrote a wonderful review of the book, which was quite generous, because Tolkien hadn't always been kind about Lewis's writing.
This book is like lightning from a clear sky. To say that in it heroic romance, gorgeous, eloquent, and unashamed, has suddenly returned at a period almost pathological in its anti-romanticism is inadequate. But in the history of romance itself, a history which stretches back to the Odyssey and beyond, it makes not a return but an advance or revolution, the conquest of new territory.
David Hartwell, senior editor at Tor Books, discusses fantasy publishing before and after Lord of the Rings.
Throughout the 1950s and early 60s, fantasy publishing in the United States took place almost exclusively in the science fiction field. What was talked about, what was the center of the discourse, was science fiction, not fantasy. And of course, Tolkien, as I say, won the International Fantasy Award, which was a science fiction award. Don Walheim printed The Lord of the Rings in mass market paperback without spending a lot of money on promotion. But he put the books out there, and the books began to sell, and they began to sell at an enormous and uncounted rate. Hundreds of thousands of copies very quickly in the Ace edition. Ian Ballantyne decided that he could publish the authorized edition, and so he contacted Tolkien, asked Tolkien to make some subtle emendations in the text. Ballantyne, of course, knew he had a gold mine and went about repackaging the Tolkien trilogy, publishing the other Tolkien books, sold many more copies than Donald A. Walheim had sold over the years, you know, enough to pay the light bills for his company for a decade.
Naturally, Tolkien influenced fantasy authors.
When the Lord of the Rings hit, and hit so hugely and opened the floodgates for so much fantasy, I got sucked along with it. The Last Unicorn did, and the rest of my books.
If you look at the rows and rows of material in this collection, Tolkien had a hammer blow impact. First of all, before Tolkien, there was very little fantasy generally available to people who were interested in it. And after Tolkien, of course, he had such a major impact on everyone. Many people went out and wrote fantasy, many people went out and read fantasy, who otherwise wouldn't have. And of course, because The Lord of the Rings was so large, it came out in three volumes, which brought to the attention of publishers that if selling one book is good, selling three books is better.
Tolkien's huge popularity led publishers to reprint old fantasy books.
This, however, was not the big bucks that publishing was looking for, and in the end, it was a financial failure. Only Lord of the Rings continued to succeed.
Are you looking for a workout that will challenge every part of your body? Then check out the Crossbow Advantage by Weider Total Workout System, only from Sears. The Crossbow Advantage combines 65 club-style exercises in one compact machine. Build muscle, burn calories, and increase flexibility. Just 20 minutes a day, 3 days a week, right at home. The Crossbow Advantage has everything you want from a workout, starting with hardcore resistance. The compound resistance system, a unique network of cables and pulleys, is the key to lengthening and strengthening muscles. It ensures better range of motion, which means faster muscle growth and more variety for your workout. The quick change resistance feature intensifies your routine. The innovative bow design lets you move from 5 to 240 pounds of resistance in just seconds. Where can you get your Crossbow Advantage? Stop by a Sears store or call now. More people buy their fitness machines from Sears than any other store in Canada. Tone and strengthen every muscle in your legs and lower body with the Leg Developer. Use the integrated lat tower to help sculpt your back, shoulders, and chest. Want an aerobic workout too? That's what the built-in rowing seat is there for. And the adjustable four-position padded bench adds comfort and support to every workout. Plus, it stores away easily. 65 club-style exercises in one, right at home. Because it's from Sears, your satisfaction is guaranteed. The Crossbow Advantage can save you inches and time, and for a lot less than comparable home gyms. Use your Sears card and pay only $79 a month at 9.9% interest with no upfront costs. Get the total workout you've been missing. Head to a Sears store, visit sears.ca, or call 1-888-607-3277 for your Crossbow Advantage today. That's 1-888-607-3277.
Despite a proven track record of widespread appeal, or perhaps because of it, Lord of the Rings continues to receive indifference or even hostility from the literati.
When the millennium came along, and there was all these books of the century competitions. Everyone was running best book of the century, best book of all time, best author, and Tolkien kept winning, and Lord of the Rings kept winning. And this drove the literary establishment crazy, because they did, but this is a very popular book. It's read by ordinary people. People can understand it. We don't like books that can be understood.
It's a very elitist reaction. They are an elite. And here is a book which expresses doubts about everything, you know, that they hold most dear, sweeping in at the top.
Where's the terrible angst, coming of age, experimenting with your own sexuality line in Lord of the Rings. I mean, you've got to have that, otherwise it's not sufficiently brave.
They saw Tolkien as a deep threat to something to which they had committed their careers and their opinions, and that was the literary movement known as modernism. And I think one of the things that really annoyed them about Tolkien was he was saying modernism isn't modern, and that the things they thought were ancient, antiquarian, you know, forgotten, etc., were actually still alive, still contemporary, still had power. They thought they'd kind of got rid of all that stuff. They thought they'd killed it, buried it at the crossroads with a stake through its heart, and they did not want it coming back, especially when it threatened to consign them and the literature they had supported to the realms of the fuddy-duddy, the scholarly, the dry as dust, all that sort of thing, which it has tended to.
The reception really speaks for itself. The millions of people around the world who love this work.
Perhaps the most striking impact of Lord of the Rings has been the many creative endeavors.
The way Tolkien has influenced me was to so introduce me to fantasy as to make me think, yes, this is my land. This is where I belong. This is, kind of who I am. I saw myself from that point on as someone who wanted to write science fiction and fantasy. For Growing Wings, what I tried to do was make it be the real day-to-day things, what it would have been like to have wings. I think that's one of the ways that I would say an influence. I'm interested in the details.
In my latest series, which is a Neanderthal parallax series, three books, hominids, humans, and hybrids, I really wanted to get a sense that the Neanderthal world that I was portraying was internally consistent and was believable. And again, it's a debt to Tolkien. You read about Middle Earth and you say, I know this place.
With Lord of the Rings, as many times as I've read it, it's always a place I can go home to and think, I don't have to try to convince myself and hope that that world existed. I, deep in my heart, I really believe that's what happened and that existed, and I'm very glad for that.
That depth, that level of really making an imaginative world that had verisimilitude, that seemed real. Tolkien set the bar very high, and all of us have been trying to at least not knock down the bar when we approach it because of the great work that he did.
I think I was seized by the idea that Middle-earth was so vivid in terms of its description that it would be interesting to try to bring these fantasy ideas into a sort of focus with really realistic pictures, just like kind of bridging the worlds in a way. And I thought that's how art can really kind of apply to fantasy. And it's a sense that, it's on the page, it's in writing, and now the artist can take it and, expand on it and create something that you can, look at and experience in a new way, in a more intensified way. The illustration I'm currently working on, which is going to be called Apparitions, and I'm working on a Two Towers calendar at the moment, so I'm taking chronological scenes, about 13 of them. So I did a sketch of a thumbnail of it very quickly, and it seemed to just come together. I just kind of saw it in my mind's eye. I quickly did a color sketch, a little watercolor. I sat down and did a full-size drawing, headed over to the library and picked up a bunch of books, give me ideas on reference for that. I will just now proceed to put in the detailing and just modify a little bit here and there. And I'm working in gouache. I start with a basic painting with wet brushing and sort of large flat-ended brushes. And then I start to refine with airbrushing and you know, sort of very more detailed work and blending and that kind of thing, and just back and forth until, you know, I finally get it. And I will do an overlay and do a final kind of picture of the characters. There's a lot of tenderness in the book at times, you know, and it's not necessarily fashionable, and it would be considered kind of schmaltzy, perhaps, or over-sentimentalized, and those are some of the criticisms of the book, you know, at times. But I think that is the heart of the book. It is a human story, a very, very poignant human story.
As Tolkien himself said in one of his letters, at least in an ideal world, he dreamed of a mythology that other people could enter into, not only guided by him, but ultimately that they would take up the creative process themselves in whatever field they may have been interested in, whether it was music or writing or poetry or whatever, and continue it and to further that creation. And so I think music is really the fundamental means by which that happens.
The CD, The Starlit Jewel, containing 13 songs from The Lord of the Rings and The Hobbit, half by Marion Zimmer Bradley, half by the two of us. And we perform most of the instruments on the recording, the Celtic harp, voices, guitar, recorders. And the other two members of our current band, Celtic and Renaissance band, Brassaliant, are also featured on the album, and we perform the material in concerts.
My mom used to sing all the songs to me when I was a kid. As she read them, she would just make them up on the spot and sing them.
We tried to stick with the instruments that were mentioned in Tolkien's works only, so we set the pieces for harp, for pipes and whistles, for voices, for strings.
We were trying to make it something that would coexist with the books.
Whether the literary elite will continue to dismiss Tolkien's work is not significant. Peter Beagle neatly illustrates this point.
Tolkien's own quatrain about the Lord of the Rings. He wrote at some point late in life, "The Lord of the Rings is one of those things. If you like it, you do. If you don't, then you boo."
The widespread and lasting appeal of Lord of the Rings is established and secure.
If it's dust you can't ignore,
Unisniffer.
On the shelf, TV and more,
Unisniffer.
Never is a chore,
Unisniffer.
Swiffer Duster's fluffy, flexible fibers trap and lock dust on contact. You've never cleaned like this before.
The Swiffer. Place looks great. It's not too late.
Beth, you're dusting my house again.
Swiffer's good.
Stop cleaning. Start Swiffering.
A T-Rex.
Oh, yeah, that's a T-Rex.
Miss Lance, will you hold my hand the whole time?
No problem.
You got it, buddy. Sure.
You've been there, on your period, and you know it's going to be a while before you can change your pad. A long while. That's why Always Maxi's extra absorbent layer helps lock wetness deep in the middle. Even hours later, Always is cleaner, drier than the next leading brand's regular Maxi. It'll last as long as you do.
Next!
Protecting all women, always.
Clean up the 90s again with Big Shiny 90s Volume 2. Featuring Econoline Crush, Third Eye Blind, Collective Soul, Ever Free, Weezer, Oasis, R.E.M., Moist, U2, Depeche Mode, Blur, Blink 182, Jane's Addiction, The Cranberries, Bare Naked Ladies, and more. Much Music's Big Shiny 90s Volume 2, in stores now.
Morgan Freeman, High Crime. And, enjoy that one, too. A very good twist ending there. I think that's...
Hey, kid! You didn't pay for that chocolate bar.
What are you talking about?
The chocolate bar I saw you put in your pocket. You didn't pay for it.
Then when on earth did you learn to steal?
But, Dad, you steal satellite signals.
13L30, Roger.
It's a pity the book didn't catch on a bit soon, isn't it?
When J.R.R. Tolkien spoke these words in 1968, he didn't foresee how pervasive and enduring his work would become.
It's as though Tolkien threw this huge rock into the lake, and the ripples have gone all over the place. And they've been a bit distorted, and they're no longer in the right shape and so on, but he's felt everywhere. I don't think that's too grand a comment. And there are other writers like this, but not many.
The astonishing thing is that nearly 50 years after its publication, it still has a living influence on what's written. The Lord of the Rings is still a primary influence on most young fantasy writers. As long as that's true, and it shows no signs of abating, then The Lord of the Rings will be a live and culturally influential work.
Beyond a commercial effect, there's something in the Lord of the Rings that's quite sorrowful. That's a mourning for something gone, whether it's that rural England of Tolkien's. It's hard to explain, but it's there.
It's not depressing sadness, as everyone who's read the book understands. There's a beauty in it. There's a deep beauty in it. This is our world. This is not a far-off planet. This is Earth. And that to do that, this is our mythology, that to recognize this is where we came from.
And I think that's the message people get from The Lord of the Rings. I think in the end it does give them hope that despite what seems like a hopeless task, you know, things look very grim, there is some hope that if we pull together, if we fight to save what we value in as non-violent a way as we can, so as not to play the enemy's game, things will work out.
Tolkien's book is timeless. It's set timelessly, and it will be as relevant because the things it deals with are also perennial and timeless: good, evil, free will, self-sacrifice. As long as we don't lapse into barbarism to such a degree that people lose the ability to read, and that's a real fear, but on the assumption that people don't lose the ability to read, the position of The Lord of the Rings as a classic of literature and a classic of mythology is assured.
There are people who are alienated and isolated, and I think what The Lord of the Rings gives them is a place where they can see that the value of loyalty and friendship and commitment to a goal means something.
God knows we've seen an incredible level of heartbreak and tragedy and atrocity in the past 100 years. And, you know, it's a very dark world we live in, truly. We don't know what kind of a future we're going to have. And I think The Lord of the Rings represents a sense of, you know, coherence and clarity and what is this about and how can we respond to it. To just be accountable for your own behavior. It can help to guide a sense of, you know, kind of a life based on certain noble principles and things of that kind, you know. It embodies the best of what a novel can be, I think, inspirational and sort of relevant.
I think it's changed people's lives, and I think it will continue to do that. It's given them something they could believe in. It's shown them the worth of little people in a world they can't control and don't really understand, which is certainly the 20th century. And it's given them a sense of beauty that I think a lot of them never had. We're still in that same tale. Don't the great tales never end? They never end as tales, but the people in them come and go, and that gives you both the mythic and the immediate adventurous dimension.
When The Lord of the Rings first came out and, you know, had a respectable measure of success, people started saying, well, it's doing all very well now, but of course it won't last, you know, it's just a passing fad. Well, they've been saying that for, you know, now 47 years. And actually, you might say a passing fad which lasts 47 years and which is about to, you know, to explode again, perhaps it isn't a passing fad. Perhaps, in fact, we're looking at a classic. The Lord of the Rings has taken on unusual popularity in areas like the former Soviet Union, so popular that they've had to ban Tolkien fans in Kazakhstan. I don't think Tolkien expected that, but that's what's happened. And clearly it is a work which has taken on entirely new meaning in the entirely unpredictable circumstances of the breakup of a former communist power. Well, I don't know what effect it's going to have, in the rest of the 21st century, but it seems to me that it is capable of continuous political reinterpretation in completely unexpected circumstances. And it does actually speak for an area of experience in the last century, which is going to continue into the next century.
And so, Lord of the Rings stands like a beacon. Or permeates like wholesome air in the drabness and gloom of modern life.
The road goes ever on and on, down from the door where it began. Now far ahead the road has gone, and I must follow if I can, pursuing it with eager feet until it joins some larger way, where many paths and errands meet, and whither then I cannot say.
We may agree with Frodo as he hands to his faithful Sam the Red Book of Westmarch, the Hobbit account of the Lord of the Rings. This great and wonderful tale is indeed part of the larger story that we all know and live.
And you will read things out of the Red Book and keep alive the memory of the age that is gone, so that people will remember the great danger and so love their beloved land all the more. And that will keep you as busy and as happy as anyone can be, as long as your part of the story goes on.
Can people be any more excited about the big game? Only if they're watching it on a new big screen. I want more!
Head to Future Shop Super Sunday Home Theater Event. Get 36 months equal payments, no interest on all home theater. Like this Toshiba 51-inch widescreen HD TV. Now with a free Toshiba Dolby Digital Surround System, a free Xbox bundle, and a free Madden 2004. All for just $72 a month. Future Shop. Come see what your future has in store.
Who doesn't have all the pets?
Sorry.
Is he coming up?
Yes.
You better get some sleep.
Okay, Mom.
Here, honey. This'll help your symptoms, so you sleep
need
like
more tissues.
Sleep like
that doesn't sound good.
It'll help you sleep like you did before your mother moved in.
I'll take it.
NyQuil, the nighttime sniffling, sneezing, coughing, aching, stuffy head, fever, so you can get the relief you need to sleep and feel better. Medicine.
Sorry.
I like your shirt.
Thanks.
See you tomorrow. I like your shirt.
It's hard to resist the soft, fresh feeling of Ultra Downy. Ultra Downy rinses right through the fabric for a lasting freshness.
Mom, how do you work this?
It's hard to resist Ultra Downy.